When we can get ourselves off chronos time and get into kairos time, that's divine time. That's the timing of God. And you can only do that by renouncing disbelief and trusting in God. The Bible tells us his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. You're not that deep. That's what the Lord told me on Friday. Y'all. I want to get right into the word of God because it's a unique word that I want to share today. But one thing we don't do, we don't question why, who, what, when, and how when the Lord gives us a word. We just give it the way that he's given it to us. Today I want to talk about something that's not the normal Women's Day type of message, but nonetheless I think it's the prophetic word of the Lord for this hour that will meet some of you in your place where you stand. The word the Lord gave me today is silenced for the protection of your blessing. Silenced for the protection of your blessing. And I'm going to be coming from Luke chapter 1 today. I want to say some things about this issue of being silenced because we all go through seasons in life where we're silenced. We may not have someone pronounce over us that we've been silenced, but we feel silent. We feel as though we don't have an influence. We feel as though we don't have a voice. We feel as though we're in a season where we're not being heard. And if we would be 100 in here today and be true, we know that there are times that we wonder even if God himself is hearing us. Yeah. We feel that we have been silenced. But this morning, the Lord was reminding me not to leave out that there's a couple of different types of silencing that can occur. There's self-imposed silencing, where you have silenced yourself because of actions that you may or may have not done. And the Lord also reminded me they are like societal imposed or life imposed situations where you may have a sickness in your body. You may have been stricken with grief, the loss of a loved one. You may be in an economical status in life where you can't seem to get out of it. You may be going through some difficult times that life has caused to take place. Those are life imposed silencing seasons where it seems like something has come to rob you or keep you in a stagnant place. So I want to talk about this word because when you look at Luke 1 and you see the pronunciation of John the Baptist coming into the world and the prophecy that's released in Luke 1, what you see is a series of silencing events. When you go to chapter 1, and we're going to be all throughout chapter 1, so just turn to Luke 1 and keep your finger there. We see that this word is found in the hearts of two people, a man and a woman, who the Bible says were faithful. The Bible says that they were true. They were servants of God. The Bible tells us even that they were blameless. In other words, they hadn't done anything that the word could stand against. The Bible tells us that at this particular time, Zacharias, who was a priest, and Elizabeth, a daughter of Aaron, they were a couple who were old in age, and the Bible says they were stricken in years. That means they weren't just old, y'all, but they were real old. And so we know that at this time, this word lands on them about their son who would come into the world at a time where Zacharias is serving. He's preparing to serve. And the Bible tells us again that they were faithful and blameless, and they continued forth in their service. But at this particular time in their lives, Elizabeth, who was barren, was experiencing some type of reproach, the Bible says. Because when the promise came forth, she made the statement, "Now the Lord has visited me and taken this reproach off of me." Now, just because we are Americans and we don't really understand what barrenness really can mean in our society, just like we don't understand what singleness can mean, we don't understand really what poverty means until you go to where two-thirds of the world live. Because, see, we live in a bubble here. I just want you all to know that two-thirds of landmass of the world is living off of less than $10 a day, and in some cases, less than a dollar. So I need us, in some cases, zero. So I want us to understand that when the Bible says that they were in a situation where she had been barren, she had been unable to produce a child, in that day, in that culture, and even in those places today, today, that's like having a curse on your life. Because then everything rested around family. You lose when you're barren the ability to carry on the family name. That's why the brother of the man, if he died, had to marry the wife. It was about carrying on a name. Also, what you find is that there was no one to care for you in your old age. See, we have all these fancy facilities now that we can go to, and we have all kind of AIDS and Medicaid and Social Security, but I want you to know they didn't have that, and in most places in the world, they still don't have it. When you're old and you don't have a child, you're out back, as the young people would say. Because you can be abused, you can be sold into slavery, or you can just be taken off the street and told that you need to do some manual labors and they'll take care of you. But I want you to know some of those people are trying to break bricks and doing that kind of thing when they're 70 and 80 years old. So when this word came forth to them, they were in a season of silencing. But it wasn't self-imposed. It was imposed by life. Because the Bible doesn't tell us why she was barren. The Bible just tells us she was barren. They were stricken in years. So decade after decade, nothing is being produced. I wish it was somebody that can understand what I'm saying today. When you live and there have been seasons where there looks like there's nothing being produced, nothing going on, all your prayers are not being answered, and you're hitting a glass ceiling and you can't find a solution. I know things are good for you now, but is there anybody that can relate to those seasons in life, in marriage, in family, in your body, when things just aren't quite adding up to your confession that you're blessed and highly favored? But the Bible tells us that they continue serving the Lord. Decade after decade, they're blameless, they're faithful, they're worshiping. He's functioning as a priest. And the Bible tells us that this thing is a matter of the heart. Because the Bible tells us that it's our heart that God is after. And so we have to deal with, when we're in seasons of silencing and barrenness, where is our heart? That's what the Lord is really looking for in those seasons. He wants to know, where is your heart? This is not about if I can bless you. This is not about if I can answer a prayer. I'm God. But what I'm looking at is, where's your heart? The Bible says in the book of Chronicles, the eyes of the Lord go to and fro, looking the whole earth, seeking to show himself mighty through someone. But it doesn't stop there. It says whose heart is turned towards him. And so in the issue of their hearts, the Bible says that they were found blameless in that they continue to serve. That's why the Bible also tells us, when you think of the heart, that our mouth makes the confession, but it's our heart that believes to salvation. Because he doesn't care really what our mouth is saying without knowing what's in our heart. And so I want to talk to someone today that's in a situation that you feel silence, and the Lord is saying today, I'm trying to get to what's in your heart. Because this isn't about me not blessing you. This isn't about me punishing you, because if that was the case, we'd all be dead. But this is about me getting into the heart of the matter. Hallelujah. I want to encourage us that in these seasons, we've got to be faithful. We're in the last and the evil days like never before. And in those days, we can't grow weary. We can't grow tired. I know we live in a microwave generation where things happen quick. And you can click a button and you can push a button. And you can get on your phone and find something on Google without even going to get an encyclopedia. But the reality is, life does not work like that. But the Bible tells us in the book of Galatians, be not weary in well doing. Because there's a due season that is coming. And if you do not faint in that season, you shall reap. And have it more abundantly. I want to encourage us. Zacharias had an assignment. The Bible tells us he was 1 week at a time. So 2 weeks out of every year, he's serving in this capacity, going into the inner chamber, into the Holy of Holies. And so again, we see that he had the mind to do what he was supposed to do and be where he was supposed to be, despite the fact that his life was upside down. They were a reproach. People were shaming them. People were saying they're cursed. People were saying that you got some issues in your household, but yet he had to function as a priest to cover other people. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Maybe you're not a priest or a pastor, but God requires you to cover other people. Even when you yourself are hurting, when you yourself things are not right in your life, when you yourself are going through and waiting on God to answer your prayer, you got to be the answer to somebody else's prayer. It's a priestly type of role, and it requires priestly maturity. That's why God is dealing with our hearts, because he's saying, I'm going to mature you. Because it's very straightforward. Sometimes you don't have to add a lot to the word, and you definitely don't take anything away. But if we can look at Luke 1, verse 8 through 17, I want to read some things about this issue of being silenced. Because again, we see that life has silenced some areas. Life situations had caused barrenness and unproductivity and seasons of stagnancy, decade upon decade, the barrenness, the ridicule, being ostracized. But I want us to look at some things that come through self-imposed barriers, self-imposed silencing, because I think that's the biggest thing that we're fighting. The Bible says and teaches us in the word that we have three enemies, that they are the world, the flesh, and the devil. And so we understand that a lot of times it's not what the devil is doing that's our real problem. It's the self-imposed stuff. It's the stuff that we are doing in this flesh that comes to be an enemy against us. So let us look at verse 8. It says, so it was that while he was serving as a priest before God in the order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, his lot fell to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people was praying outside at the hour of incense. Yeah. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is now heard. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he shall neither drink wine or strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Ghost, even in his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. He will also go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Amen. I want to say this, that first of all, this pronunciation of the blessing met Zacharias in the place of service. It didn't meet him in the secret prayer closet. It didn't meet him out in the community working. It met him in the place of spiritual service. There are certain things that I have learned, and the Holy Spirit has even recently shown me, that you won't tap into until you are in spiritual service. And I want you all to understand that it's not just about ushering, and it's not just about God. we don't have ourselves together. Can we agree? There's some things in the house of God that we ought not do if we don't have ourselves together. But the idea that God is waiting on us to be perfect is far from true. So we gotta find the balanced place in the middle where we understand that God's works are perfect, but the people he uses are imperfect. But yet it doesn't stop him from using imperfect people to accomplish a perfect work. So he's not moved about all your issues and struggles and rationalizations and all of that. He's saying, look, I just need you to be in the place of serving. Because somebody in the body, somebody outside the door, somebody in your neighborhood needs what it is that you have. Can you imagine? 4 centuries have gone by. And now this angel approaches an old priest. their children, turning the disobedience to wisdom and making ready a people for the Lord. I want somebody to know today that there's a promise over your head that God has called you. He's called you in this hour to cause that reformation and restoration to come forth. That there's someone assigned to you. And God wants to birth something out of your life bigger than a car or a house. He wants to birth something out of your life that's kingdom business. That's a gift that no man can produce. That's greater than what somebody can sign on a form and give you the mortgage or the key to something that a storm can destroy. He's trying to birth something out of you that brings people out of darkness and into the marvelous light. That causes in a generation that's wayward and confused and don't have the identity because many of their fathers neglected them and their mothers was all about themselves. That he needs to bring some kind of restoration and turn them. But it's you and I that's going to be used for that. How can we sit somewhere and function in ritualism? How can we get stuck in our room on the computer or in a prayer closet and think we are not going to have to come out eventually and deal with what God called us to do? He says, I brought you out of darkness into the marvelous light that you'll show forth.
Come on, man. Take your time.
Jesus. So God meets Zachariah in the place of worship and says, even after decades that you've been declaring and blessing others, that you have waited for your blessing, where you haven't seen anything produced of any magnitude out of your own life and service, I'm coming in this season of your life specifically to let you know that in the midst of unproductivity, in the midst of unfruitfulness, in the midst of stagnancy, I'm about to do something because it's my time, not your time. Hallelujah. I want somebody to understand that this is God's time for your life. I don't care what season you're in. I don't care if you're a senior citizen, a baby boomer, generation X, Y, or Z. If you're in this hour, it's time for God to do something in your life. You. I'm going to show you my marvelous plans for your life. I'm going to bring something through you that nobody expected me to bring. See, they just thought you was just a priest. They just thought you went back and forth and did this ritual. But what I'm doing now is shaking things up. Because I want you to know God is doing something in the hour that he's preparing people to be ready for the Lord. Now, if somebody talks about and come and prophesy that you're about to get a BMW, some keys and a business that everybody Zacharias said unto the angel, whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. Now, he says, whereby shall I know this? Gabriel is standing in front of you. But you ask him for another sign? Gabriel has showed up in the Holy of Holies while you're praying for the people. But you say, but whereby shall I know this? As if Gabriel himself was not enough. I want to say something to some people before I move forward. That God has given you confirmation after confirmation. Woke you up in the middle of the night, allowed you to be healed from sickness that could have actually took you off the face of earth. You could have went and met Jesus. But for some reason, he woke you up. And it wasn't just for you to turn the key to a BMW or Lexus. I just don't believe that's the kind of God we serve. A God that clothed himself in humanity, came into this world. The Bible says, because the devil had your mind. And we're still saying, but how shall I know this? What's going to be the sign, Lord? The sign is you're living in the last evil days. And somehow, I breathed in you today. Somehow, I declare my mercy endures to all generations, and they're new every morning, which means if you messed up on the Saturday night special, I just want you to know you showed up today with breath in your body. When Zacharias responded as he did, and it wasn't the response that was the real issue, it was the heart again. He revealed that even though I'm a priest, even though I've been serving in this magnitude all these years, even though I'm praying for the people and giving them the priestly blessing, something in me now, I'm faithful, I'm blameless, but in the nook and cranny of the heart, something doesn't believe that this can happen. See, Zacharias revealed that even in faithfulness and obedience to his religious duties in his heart, he lacked true faith. I'm telling you, I just learned something on Friday about myself. You know, you can do some things and then people can pat you on the back so much you forget that it's some things you're not doing that they don't see. Can I keep it real? Trust me for the going to the bush. You trust me for to be stopped in a car and robbed. You trust me for to be persecuted in India. But somehow you don't trust me to do what I told you to do over there in Norfolk in that little area. There's areas, if we can be real, that we often don't trust God. There's areas of disbelief. That's why the man, God honored him when he said, Lord, I believe, but healing has been released. Somebody can be real today and say, Lord, is a self-imposed barrier. See, the situation with the barrenness couldn't be controlled. But your response to what God wants to do can be. But in his heart was disbelief. So now there's a barrier in what God wants to do, or how he receives what God wants to do, because of his own issues. God knows we have issues, church. He knows this. We've had them from the beginning, and we're going to have them until he returns. But the question that we have to ask ourselves, and I want us to think on this. This isn't a hallelujah, amen moment. It's a moment to just ponder something for a second or two. What is the area today of disappointment, stagnancy, abuse, confusion, deception, lies, or whatsoever it is that has caused you to have a stagnant area in your life that could be now controlled? Because God is saying, he whom the sun sets free is free indeed. He's saying you're more than a conqueror with me and you. He's saying that if God be for you, who can be against you? So what's the little teeny area? It might not be big, but what's the little one that's causing us to now say, in the midst of receiving a word from God, as Zachariah did, receiving a word from the angel, it was like Zachariah said to the angel, look, I hear you, but I need you to go back and tell the God who specializes in making the impossible possible that this is impossible. I mean, in a sense, that's what he was doing. Can you imagine how God is offended when we do that? Years after praying and asking, now the angel says the prayers have been heard. But now in that moment, something has to happen. He has to be silenced. If we go on down to verse 20, it says, and behold, thou shalt be silent and not able to speak until the day that these things shall come to pass. Because you didn't believe my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. So now he's silenced because of his disbelief and his distrust. Not because it can't be done, because he doesn't believe it can be done. But let me tell you what God is doing in this hour, because it's so serious. When you look at this story, you know God himself didn't stop the blessing. He didn't stop the promise, because the promise had to come into pass. The Bible says God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he needs to repent. So we see that John still came on the scene despite Zachariah's issue. But what happened? He had to silence Zachariah. In other words, I got to take your influence right now. I got to take your voice right now. I got to let you be in a strange place, in a strange situation. And I've got to take your ability to do what you normally do. You know, as a priest, he had to talk. It was his job to bless people. Even in this very holy of holies, if you study the scripture, you know he was coming out, and the next thing the people were waiting on was the pronunciation of a blessing over them. But he left that room, and he couldn't even pronounce the blessing over them because he could not talk. God is saying to us today that there's some things that he has allowed to happen to silence us. You know, the silencing was twofold. It was protection for the blessing, but if you study, it was also a form of punishment. Because God, can we keep it real? We serve a God of grace, but if we want to think we don't get punished, we are crazy. If we want to think that there's no consequences to sin, we are crazy. And I want you to know that the sin of disbelief, the sin of doubting, the sin of deception is just as bad as the sin of adultery, fornication, lesbianism, homosexuality. I know y'all don't like it, but when God sees sin of any kind, he doesn't like it. He don't like any of it. So even the man of God here, he had sinned in his disbelief. And there was a punishment. He said, I'm going to now silence you, and you will not be able to speak until the day that these things shall come to pass. You know, there's even a promise for somebody while you're silenced. Amen. That's the wonderful thing about God. Y'all should just give and lift your hands and praise him for that. That when he has to silence me, when he has to chastise me, when I have messed up, when I have He's still saying the thing that I promised, I want to bring it to pass. I'm going to bring it to pass. Hallelujah. And so we understand that God is in this season birthing something. And again, it's not about our perfection because he's going to bring it to birth. But what it is about is our heart. See, he said, I got to silence you. And we have to understand that disbelief renders us powerless to be a blessing to others. Sure, okay, you can write a check. Sure, you can say something out of your mouth. But the kind of power and blessing that God wants us to release in the lives of our family members, in the lives of our children. And I don't mean just blessing them for doing good. I'm talking about speaking to some stuff that's out of order and bringing it into order. You can't have the power to do that when you don't believe. The Bible says signs and wonders will follow who? Those who believe. Those who believe, signs and wonders will follow them. But when it's some issues about your own rationalization and analyzing and stuff because you got issues, you don't fully believe. That's why we don't see miracles and things. It is not about all this deep stuff we try to say, the locality and the reasoning. No, signs and wonders shall follow those that believe. It didn't say just those who believe in India and Africa, those who believe in other parts of the world. No, those who believe, signs and wonders follow them. Why are we saying it? Because we're still analyzing the things of God. A thinker like me, you just think too much, way too much. Your mind is working all the time. It's working against you. I got delivered on Friday when I was able to meet with my apostle from overthinking. Because what I realized that I still do too much thinking. And God said that he is the spirit of truth. That we have the Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth, but we aren't the Holy Spirit. That means what you try to rationalize and analyze is truth. From the east is and from the west of God's truth. He may be trying to do something in your life, in your daughter, in your son, that maybe you wouldn't have thought was right for them. Maybe it wouldn't have been the thing that you would have chose, but maybe it's the thing that's going to take them to the place God wants them. Some of the things that he wants to do, the Bible tells us his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. You're not that deep. That's what the Lord told me on Friday. Y'all, you're not that deep. You're not that intelligent. You don't know me that well. Like you want to say that you know me. I got different depths of me that you can't even see until you hit 60 and 70. It's things that you aren't experiencing in me that you haven't experienced now. So I need you to get back in line. See, the Lord is bringing us back in line. Because I want y'all to know there's some self-imposed barriers in here. We're going to break them today. Because we're not going to leave out of here in our own shackles that we put on ourselves. It's long enough that we've been shackled by society and oppression. Do you think I'm going to shackle myself when the Lord says he set me free, that I can be whatever he has called me to be, that there's no limitation or restriction on what he will do with me? He's no respecter of person. He doesn't care if you're Jew, if you're Gentile, if you're a woman or a man. He doesn't care if you're Greek or Hebrew. Those superhero movies, but we ain't ready to be no superheroes for God. The Bible said in verse 21, and the people were waiting for Zacharias, and they marveled while he tarried in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak to them. Hallelujah. I want you all to understand that God has called you to speak to some stuff. God has called you to speak to some people. God has called you to do some things. There's gifts in every one of us. Because the Bible says he distributed gifts to all the men and women, all men, mankind. And so there's something that you need to do in this hour that you haven't done. And God is saying today, whatever that hindrance is, it's going to be released. It's going to be broken by faith today. See, he contended with his head and not his heart. His head was the thing that was thinking about his limitations, his age, restricting in years. You haven't done this yet. See, I want to tell y'all why sometimes we don't have peace. Can I help somebody get a new level of peace that when you leave today, you're going to go to another level in your peace? You're going to because you're going to start understanding that God does not function in chronos and chronological timelines. Jesus looked at those people and said, my kingdom is not of this world. In other words, me and my Father don't function like you all. We don't think like you all. We don't have boundaries and barriers and restrictions of time and seasons like you all. We are the God of all things, of the whole earth. We set the times and the seasons. But see, in us, we have this chronological issue where everything got to be a certain way. That's what makes us rush and get into stuff we shouldn't be in. That's what makes us say our biological clock is ticking, ladies. All of that stuff about a time clock that was set by somebody that's not your king. Somebody that didn't write and offer the word of God. Because we become so sensitive to this thing of time. By this age, I got to have this. By this time, I got to be married. By this time, I got to have this much money ready for retirement. By this time, I got to do this. And you put yourself in bondage when God himself operates in the fullness of time. Your fullness of time might not require all, but your fullness of time also might mean you got to labor and walk and go through in a period of time that you're not happy with. But either way, it's the fullness of his time. That's why he says he makes all things beautiful in his time. When we can get ourselves off chronos time and get into kairos time, that's divine time, that's the timing of God, and you can only do that by renouncing disbelief and trusting in God, saying, God, I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I know at the appointed time, not the calendar day where this is going to be cut off or this is going to happen or at this time that check is going to stop, at this time you're going to be called about this. No, no, no. In the realm of the spirit, see, we are spiritual beings. In the realm of the spirit, God said, I need you to trust me that I'm doing something in my time and my way that's going to help you through all that chronological stuff. But first, I need you to acknowledge Kairos time. And the only way you can do that is be with me. Be in my will. Know the word of the Lord. Lay before the Lord. Get peace and rest in his presence. Understand that it's he that is your maker, that he is the author and the finisher of your faith. He is Jehovah Jireh, your provider. Hallelujah. The cause of his silencing was being stuck in that chronological time. That chronological time wiped him out. It wiped him out. The Bible tells us, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our mind. It says, then you will become the evidence or the proof of what is the good, perfect, and acceptable will of the Lord. When you are transformed in your thinking, that's when God begins to use you to be the evidence of what God's good will is, his perfect will, and his acceptable will. And can I tell you all a little secret? It doesn't matter your background or your situation. It doesn't matter your sins. It doesn't matter what happened to you in the past, because he actually did say, I work all things together for that good will. That means the good, the bad, and the ugly, the right and the wrong, the messiness and the fix. I work it all together for the good of them who what? Love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. You called on every side. That's why I say I'll tell my testimony, because the devil is certainly going to tell it. But I'm going to tell it because God got me in the front, he got me in the back, and he got me on both sides. And I'm kept by him. But some of us have been silenced and hidden. But I want you to know today it was for the protection of the blessing that God wants you to have. Because God said, you know what? I'm still going to bring John the Baptist into the world. I'm still going to bless your household and you're going to be filled with joy and gladness. I'm still going to cause your wife to conceive when you are with her. But I'm going to just take you off of it for a little bit. Because I want you to watch this thing unfold since you didn't believe. I want you to see the stomach get bigger. I want you to see her celebrating and singing the songs unto me. I want you to see the people marveling and coming around looking at what's going on. You're not going to be able to say anything because, see, I can't risk your mouth opening up right now. But I want you to see it, because as you see it and you watch, see, some of y'all, it's not your experience, but you're watching some people. And as you're watching them, you're growing. You're developing. You're coming into some understanding. And God said, I don't want you to just watch somebody else. I want you to be watched. Hallelujah. I'm going to close here. And it says that in the end of this thing, I'll say verse 57, if we can just skip there. Now Elizabeth, full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth a son. If we skip down to verse 63, it says, and Zacharias asked for a writing tablet and wrote, saying, his name is John. So they all marveled. Verse 64 says, immediately his mouth was open, his tongue was loose, and he spoke and praised God. In that moment, what happened was God needed to know that Zacharias had caught up with what he's doing, and that he wasn't worried about people, the fellow priests, the people in the community. And you know why I say that? Because they were squandering over the name. John, where's John? That's nobody in your heritage's name, John. Nobody in your lineage's name, John. They were saying what should be based on tradition and culture. But when you get loose from people, see, some of y'all stressed out, headache, because you're trying to live up to the expectation of another human being. Living up to what they say you should be, what you should have. Going broke. Can I just talk this black people in here? I know my own people. Going broke, getting in debt to keep up with the Joneses, as they say, or to prove that you got something. That's why I don't do a whole lot of fellowship with a lot of bishops and preachers in my personal time, because I don't want to hear about all that. I just want to be content in the state and season that I'm in. I want to hear what the Lord is saying for me. I don't want nobody telling me what I need and need to go get. I don't want to be influenced that way. See, some of us can get caught up in that, but God was saying, I, after all this, I think Zechariah knows now that I am the true and living God. He's not just coming in lighting some candles, but he recognizes that what I said, I shall surely perform it. That I am the God of the whole earth. And the Bible tells us that at that appointed time, when it was time to speak what God said, that Zechariah finally lined up with what God said. And he said, bring me a tablet, because see, I've watched this thing long enough. I've been silenced for 42 weeks and I'm tired of not having any influence. I'm tired of watching my wife and yet I'm not doing anything. I'm tired of not being able to function in my role. Bring me a tablet, because God said his name shall be John. When Zacharias lined up with what God said, his mouth immediately opened up. I came to pronounce to somebody, maybe it ain't for everybody because everybody ain't ready, but I know it's a remnant in here that is ready, that's ready to open up your mouth and make a difference, that's ready to open up your mouth and get in alignment with what God is trying to do in your life. There's certain things you're not going to receive until you line up with God's purpose, until you get in the place of worship, until you get in the position of serving his people. And I want you to know that the time is now. The time is now. God is saying, I want to do this thing now. The Bible says that the time is now. Shall you not know it? I'm going to make a way in the wilderness. See, you're too busy worried about what's out there. But God said, I'm going to make a way in the wilderness. That means I don't have to know how he's going to do it. See, the Bible says the just, that means those in right standing with him, they live by faith. We drink faith. We eat faith. We digest faith. We are faith. And if we got to lose something, we just have to lose it. But if we gain something, we just have to gain it. And God is saying, I'm tired of people that get ahead of their way. God is saying, I'm going to do something new. Hallelujah. Can everybody stand to your feet? If I can just pray and then release the service back into the hands of the women of God. Hallelujah. 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 Can we just take a few seconds just to meditate right there? I don't see you can rush some stuff and leave out and just go right out the door and be the same old way. Get back in that same old way of thinking. But I want us to take a Holy Ghost pause. And I declare the Spirit of the Lord touching the mind of your people, that Father God, if they've been silenced because of life, if they've been silenced because of abandonment or abuse or physical issues, just life, other people, situations, that Father, you don't let them know that they don't have to stay there. If they've been silenced because they didn't trust you and you have to back them up for a minute, maybe some of you spoke to them, they had zeal and fire, but something came in.